acting. To become great at it takes years. An old saying in the New York theater world is that it takes 20 years to make a great actor. You just keep chiseling away at it. My understanding of this is that after an actor has spent years perfecting their voice and their physical abilities and their ability to analyze a script and all the craft it takes to perform on the stage, it still takes 20 years to remove all the nonsense that rattles around in the mind so that during a performance the actor is simply presenting a human being responding 100% honestly to everyone and everything around them while trying to achieve whatever it is their character wants. Acting is something that is very simple in theory and very hard in practice. In order to be a successful actor, you must have talent. What is talent? I have no idea, but I know it when I see it. Is it the ability to sing well? No. Singing is a talent. But being able to sing doesn't make someone a good actor. It might help them be a good performer, but there is a difference between performers and actors. A performer's chief concern is entertaining the audience. An actor is also concerned with entertaining the audience, but it isn't the chief concern. What is the actor's chief concern? That is a very complex question that we will barely scratch the surface of in this class. In order to be a successful actor, you also must have another virtually invisible quality, stage presence. Stage presence is a sort of magic or charisma. Stage presence can be nurtured and developed, but some people are born with it in abundance, while others seem to have none. If you are one of the very luckiest actors, you will be rich and famous. If your goal is to be rich and famous, trying to achieve it through acting is one of the stupidest paths to choose. Acting is hard work. Acting involves rejection after rejection after rejection, if you're lucky. Because if you're being rejected, it means you're auditioning. Sometimes getting the audition is so hard that it feels like the victory, but getting cast is the real victory. And once you get cast, the job is only going to last a finite and usually short period of time. An actor's job is looking for work, even when they are working. Yes, there are the rarest of examples of people being discovered at their first audition and somehow turning that lucky break into stardom. You have a greater chance of winning the lottery and being struck by lightning at the same time, twice on the same day, as you do at becoming an overnight star. So how to act, how to create your character, has historically been in two different ways. External acting, acting from the outside in, deciding what the character looks like on the outside, how they walk, talk, gesture, etc., and allowing this to seep in and create an internal life. And then internal acting, acting from the inside out, creating the internal life of the character first, how they feel and why they feel that way and what they want and what they are willing to do to get it, and letting that filter outward to create the outer life organically. Actor training, that is, with a teacher, is only about 125 years old. Before that, a young actor would apprentice with a company and learn from the more experienced actors. Most of the time, this was by watching them more than it was the experienced actors teaching the young actors what they were doing. Inside-out acting was started chiefly by a Russian actor, producer, director, playwright, and teacher named Konstantin Stanislavsky. He was one of the first people to try and develop a system of training and an approach to acting that would result in an honest performance. Before him, there was almost no actor training, and what existed was chiefly limited to physical and vocal training. Stanislavski delved into how the intellect was involved in acting and how to train it. Almost all American actor training is based on his system. The most famous of them is what is referred to as method acting, which many of you have probably heard about. I could talk about Stanislavski's influence on theater for hours, but I'll try to hold myself to a short, clear overview of how his main thoughts are used today. Given circumstances. These are the facts that the actor must accept and work with. Age, sex, health, social or class status, educational levels, etc. Also, concrete relationships to others in the cast, i.e., their parents, siblings, best friends, spouse, etc. Now note that this is just who the person is to the character. It's not how they feel about them. No two people feel the same way about their parents. No two people feel the same way about their siblings. And no person feels exactly the same way about each of their best friends. Most of the concrete information is contained in the script, with some of it in other characters' dialogue or stage directions. However, some of it must be made up. If you were to play Hamlet, for example, among many other things, you have to decide how old you are. Shakespeare didn't tell you. And you must decide if he's healthy, how intelligent he is, if he loves his mother or hates his mother, or maybe even is in love with his mother. Motivation. The idea is a simple one. People's actions are done for a reason. Everyone has a reason for what they do. Often in life, these reasons seem insignificant because whatever the person is doing isn't very important. But plays normally take place on a day or days something special happens to the character. On these days, the reason you are doing what you are doing becomes very significant indeed. It sounds like a Sting song, but every breath you take, every move you make, every step you take is motivated. Every action is the result of a choice.
Every breath you take, and every move you make, every bond you break, every step you take, I'll be watching you. Every single day, and every word you say, every game you play, every night you stay, I'll be watching you.
Objective. Motivation and objective are closely linked. Your motivation, the reason you choose to do what you do, is because of what you want. Your objective. Wanting something motivates you to try and get it. Super objective. This is the one thing that the character wants above all else. It is what they are fighting for. It is always expressed in an active way. In Star Wars, Luke might be fighting to save the galaxy. He might be fighting to avenge his murdered aunt and uncle. He might be fighting to win the love of Princess Leia. Any of these, and more, could be Luke's super objective. So then, every line has a mini objective. When you talk to the other characters, you are trying to get them to help, or at least get them to not hinder you in achieving your objective for the scene. Achieving your scene objective brings you one step closer to achieving your super objective. This connected path from each line, each movement, each breath helping you towards your scene objectives, which in turn helps you towards your super objective, is oftentimes referred to as your through line, or the spine of the character. If this through line isn't whole or doesn't make sense, the character, as portrayed by the actor, isn't whole and doesn't make sense. Acting from the outside in is much easier to talk about. It is much more concrete than inside-out acting. It is simply imagining how you want your character to be perceived and creating that. Is it easy? No. To be good at it is quite difficult. It takes an amazing ability to observe and analyze human behavior, and being able to take it on as if it were you. The problem with outside acting, the one that Stanislavski was trying to overcome, was that much of the time, outside-in acting doesn't appear to be honest on an emotional level. The actor decides what emotions they're going to pretend to have, and depending on how good they are at pretending and how good they are at deciding which emotion is right for the moment, can determine whether the performance feels honest, false, or even laughable. Imagine that an actor has decided that when their scene partner screams at them, they are going to break down into a sobbing mess on the floor. That's the way they rehearsed the scene, and that's how they have decided to play it. However, one night, during performance, for whatever reason, their scene partner barely raises their voice in the scene. Since they've rehearsed breaking down into a sobbing mess on the floor, that's what they do. But that moment is now all wrong and would probably cause the audience to laugh. In performance, every night is different. Every night is new. If the actor in the above moment hasn't predetermined their reaction, rather they have only predetermined what their objective is and what their relationship to the other character is, when their scene partner gives them something different to respond to, they respond differently. A play's performance should be new and different every night, all within the parameters set by the rehearsal process. The only thing that is set in stone are the words in the script. Modern acting theory incorporates both outside-in and inside-out acting. If an actor is well-versed in both approaches, they can decide how much of which to use with each new project. If you're in a show that requires you to play multiple characters, being able to make them distinct using outside-in techniques is vitally important, while using inside-out techniques to make each of them have inner truth means that you haven't just created an outline of a character, but a fully fleshed-out one. When acting schools first started, 125 years ago or so, the first year was often given solely to physical training. The thought was that actors had to learn their instrument, i.e. their bodies, and get them tuned up. In the U.S., with the rise of method acting, emphasis on the body was set aside because the focus was on the internal, not the external. Most acting schools now require that their students be in, or get in, and remain in shape. They need to be limber, toned, and ready to take on whatever physical demands a role might require. Not all actors achieve this level of preparedness, but if they don't, they are limiting themselves. My grad school acting teacher put it this way: if you can only play 3 or 4 keys on the piano, you can only be cast in a limited number of roles. If you can play all 88, cast in any role.